Oh, okay, thank you. Oh, it fell over. I think I'll just put it back where I had it. At least it tends to be somewhat stable there.
Yeah, I've got the same problem. You know, these little lightweight fabrics don't hold these clips too well.
Yeah.
I think mine...
God, I guess the last time I was home in Dallas was this spring.
Yeah, I knew you were there. I didn't think I could, but it's been...
Well, we did
oh, right. Okay, I think we got to start this interview, Howard, by saying you're outnumbered by Texans. So
I know.
Watch your step.
You go right ahead and just talk.
Now I'm on home turf, Howard.
We'll get to my hometown sooner or later.
What is your hometown?
Seattle.
I thought we did Seattle yesterday, didn't we do Seattle?
No,
I guess we did Portland and all those other places up there yesterday.
Not Seattle. Oh.
But really, the thing we have in common at the moment is Flamingo Road. Mm. And the two of you are playing starring roles in that. And Morgan, for you, a former SMU student.
Briefly, yeah.
Yeah, briefly. You have what sounds like an absolutely marvelous role in Flamingo Road.
Oh, it's a lot of fun. I think Howard and I both have a lot of fun sort of being bad guys in the thing.
Is this anything at all like your role in Search for Tomorrow?
Oh, no, because she was really crazy. By the end.
She was really crazy.
I mean, she was killing people and stuff. So far, I haven't killed it. I don't know. I haven't seen the whole Bible for the show. Do I kill anybody? Am I going to be really crazy right off the bat? Well, it took me 3.5 years to get that bonkers. But they finally put me away in an asylum for the criminally insane. So I don't think this girl's going to be quite that bad, at least initially.
What is your relationship with Howard in Flamingo Road?
Rather distant.
Oh, right.
Sort of disdainful of him, but know that we need him.
I know something about her that she doesn't know, however. Mm-hmm. I know that she is the illegitimate daughter of Stella Stevens.
The town madam.
The town madam.
And I know that I'm adopted, but I don't know where I came from. And Kevin McCarthy is my father, and Barbara Rush is my adopted mother. And I'm just a very spoiled rich kid because they are the wealthiest family in town. I have no idea that I have this skeleton lurking in the closet.
See, that's my character knows everything that has gone on in the town. He's got it all in here and in his little desk. And he has something on almost everybody.
Blackmail.
Well, that's right, the way he controls the people. Now he controls the town, runs the town.
What was it that intrigued you about this part, Howard?
That power. That capacity for evil. No, I think there's something interesting about it. A guy who is... you know, who is really so ruthless. And I think that's about what he is. He's really ruthless.
Power freak.
Yeah, he's a power freak. Like Morgan's made up that appellation for me.
Howard, you know, it's a wonderful thing, I think, and maybe you will disagree, but I think it's an absolutely wonderful thing that young people who weren't even born at the time of Sam Spade know and have a great affinity for Sam Spade.
Isn't that amazing? Yeah, it is.
What do you think it is?
I don't know. Maybe we were doing something right. I don't know. In those days, you mean the pirated versions of the show that are all over?
They just know
yeah, I don't
about
know where
Sam
they come from. Yeah.
They know and they appreciate.
It's amazing. I don't know how they know it, except that there must be some recordings and tapes around.
Well, we ain't dumb. We don't think life began in 1960.
Yeah, but this is a show that was on, it was a radio show, you know, and a lot of people didn't know there was such a thing as radio.
But there's a real revived interest in that around the country. I know when I lived in New York, I was doing a lot of CBS Mystery Theaters that they're marketing all over the country.
I've done some Mystery Theaters, series of Mystery Theaters.
Yeah, I mean,
Elliot Lewis, I don't know, what do you know?
No, I don't know him, but there's a market for that around the country now. I think people are sort of getting intrigued with it again, loving to sit around.
Well, I'd like to see that personally,
you
know, because we had a lot of fun doing that sort of thing, and you know,
the most fun is that
God knows it's easy. You know, you just read those lines and no makeup, no nothing.
Oh yeah, it's great. But the most fun is the sound man watching him do all the sound effects and everything, and clomping feet across the thing and slamming doors and creaking and all the kinds of things
like
that
when
go into
to
it.
Fall.
Yeah.
He is evil, isn't he?
Yeah, we've lost a few sound men that way.
Morgan, when you left SMU to go to New York to be an actress, Did your parents just have a fit?
Well, let me clarify this. First off, I went to SMU very, very briefly, just mostly in the night school, because I got married very young, and I didn't have time to go to school. I've been working professionally since I was about 17, and it always seemed like every time I'd want to enroll in college, there would be a show that I'd have to go out with. So, no, but in answer to your question, no, they didn't freak so badly. By the time I got divorced, my husband and I already had an apartment in New York, and my sister was going to Juilliard up there in the drama division, and so we sort of stuck together in New York against the big city. I think most people who knew me were a little worried, because I'm kind of shy, and I think a lot of people thought New York would really chew me up, but you learn to survive.
How did you learn? What did you have to change to survive?
Well, you find a real sense of yourself, or you cave in, because there's so much rejection just inherent in this business that you have to be able to say, well, they're wrong. They're wrong. And you have to keep saying they're wrong. All the times they turn you down, and you have to keep saying they're wrong, and I know that I'm a good actress and a good person and all of this. But I think having my sister up there helped a whole lot, because we had each other to talk to, and that kind of bond. We've always been real close anyway, even more than a lot of sisters. And so there was that kind of thing of feeling like we were together in it. I think my mother worried a little about both of us, though.
Art, of course, your movie, Kramer versus Kramer, is still playing to wonderful houses. At the time that you were making that movie with Dustin, did you have any idea that it would be the big blockbuster and Academy Award winner?
I think we all thought it was going to be a very good picture. I don't think any of us thought that it was going to be the blockbuster that it turned out to be, no. At least I didn't think
but
so.
But that's hard to tell.
One doesn't know. I think everybody had a lot of faith in the movie, but I don't know. It's pretty hard to predict a blockbuster.
When I was 16, I was working on Bonnie and Clyde in Dallas, and, you know, Warren Beatty was really the only star of that period that was in it, and so many good people came out of it, but nobody had any idea it was going to be that kind of big hit, and that so many careers would be made out of that movie. Gene Hackman and Gene Wilder had a little part. Bonnie and Clyde.
Oh, yeah.
Faye Dunaway. I mean, it was like Faye's third movie, but it was the one that really set her off and made her a star. And Estelle Parsons, so many good people.
Yes, and I think it was not the easiest project to mount. I think Warren had some problems getting it.
There were a lot of problems, and the screenplay had been kicking around for a long time. So nobody knew. You never know going in. Even if you have a terrific picture, when you finish with it, it still doesn't mean people are going to pay to see it and that you're going to have a hit. But you never know going in quite what's going to happen. That's sort of the gamble of it. It's kind of fun.
Howard, you have lots of experience in this business. Do you think Flamingo Road's going to be a hit?
Yes.
Do you really?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, what else can he say, Bobby?
No, I know Howard is very outspoken, and if he wanted to, he would cushion it by saying, well, we hope so, or, yeah. You know.
No, I really do. I have as much confidence in this as I've had in almost anything I've done.
You think it'll be compared with Dallas?
I'm sure it's inevitable.
Yeah. Does that bother you?
No. Not so far.
Okay. Hey, it's good talking with both of you. Howard, nice to meet you. I've never met you before.
Nice to meet you.
And Morgan, good to see you. Come back to Texas as soon
as
you can.
Thank you.
Okay. Thank you both.